Vagishadya sumanasaha sadvarthana upakrame yam natva krisakritya sihutam namami gajananam parthaya pratibhojitam bhagavata narayanena swayam vyasena gratitam purana munina madhye mahabharatam advaita amrita varshanim bhagavatim ashtadashadhyayinim Ambatvamanasandadami Bhagavad Gita Bhavatveshneem Mukam Karoti Vacharam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yatkripa Tamaham Bande Paramananda Madhavam Sadashiva Samarambham Shankara Acharya Madhyamam Asmada Acharya Paryantam Bande Guru Paramparam Yoginam Vishwanatha Kyam Asmattata Swarupinam Atmalabhat paramlabham vakta aram nakadachana Gita artha grantakartaram sri gurum pranamam yagam Yuntav pravishyamevacham dhritim buddhim prachodayat Om namas sabhabhya sabhapati bhyascha O namaham Om Friends, we are going to be doing Gita Regimen for Advaitic Living number 25. Today, we shall be seeing chapter 4, shloka numbers 29 to 35 today. We shall spend a few minutes recalling the context. What is it Krishna is doing? He is describing, after that famous shloka, Brahmarpanam Brahmahavihi Brahmagnau Brahmanahutam Brahmaiva Tena Gantavyam Brahmakarma Samadhina, shloka number 24, shloka number 24. After that, he has been describing various yajnas that seekers are practicing. Why is he describing these various yajnas? He wants to show you there are different ways of propitiating the absolute through these yajnas and helping ourselves. I mean, it is a sadhana. This sadhana helps ourselves to lift ourselves from the individual consciousness to the absolute consciousness. This is a kind of a transmutation of the individual consciousness to become the absolute consciousness. Devameva pare yajnam, it starts there, shloka number 25. That is why he laid the foundation stone in 24, where he said everything is Brahman, and he used the metaphor of the Vedic yajna, that for the yajna, the ladle is Brahman, the havis is Brahman, the fire is Brahman, the one who offers is Brahman. So everything is Brahman. That was what was told there. So in each shloka, 25 to 31, the seven shlokas, he is telling you various yajnas where the lower self or a lower entity, whatever it be, is surrendering and offering itself to the higher entity or the higher self. So that is how we have come to this shloka 29. Apane juhvati pranam prane panam tatha pare pranapana gati rudvam pranayama parayanaham. In shloka number 28, he talked about yoga yajna. Yoga yajna. Yoga yajna. Yoga consists of ashtanga yoga. There are eightfold things. I have told you how the various things except the pranayama. All the other things are already covered in shloka 26, 27 and 28. So the pranayama part of the ashtanga yoga is covered here. We are going to be spending quite some time on this shloka because it is going to, there is a common portion between this shloka and the theory of pranayama. So here he says, so we are going to take Apane Jukvati Pranam, the shloka 29, and the first line of shloka 30. Apare Niyata Hangaraha Pranam Prane Shujukvati. So those three lines, 29, two lines, and 31st line. Of the Eightfold Yoga, the Pranayama is spoken of here. Prana and Apana. What is Prana? Prana is the outgoing breath, the exhaling breath, Prana. Apana is the inhaling, incoming breath, the breath that is inhaled. Now, Pranayama Parayanaya. So they are intent on breath control. And what do? They block the movement of prana and apana in various different ways. So he is talking about that here. Apane juhvati pranam. Pranam apane juhvati. Pranam, the prana, the outgoing breath, is offered, juhvati. You know, everywhere I told you, the lower thing is offered to the higher thing. Lower entity is offered to the higher entity, and effacing itself, if a self-effacement. So here, apane juhvati pranam, pranam apane juhvati. Prana is offered in apana. The outgoing breath is sacrificed to the incoming breath, apane. So the out breath is sacrificed to the in breath. This means the air which is going out is taken in, is in inside, it is not let out. So this is called puraka function of pranayama. Puraka is filling up. Puraka. Puraka function of pranayama. So what puraka does, they fill the external air into the body. Other people, apane juhvati pranam, prane panam tata apare apare, prane apanam. First he said pranam apane. Now he says prane apanam, prane apanam. That is, in the outgoing breath, the incoming breath is sacrificed. What does it mean? In the outgoing breath, the incoming breath is sacrificed. Which means the rechaka, that is the emptying out or throwing out. So the incoming breath is satisfied, is sacrificed into the prana, outgoing breath. So it is outgoing breath that is dominates now. So it takes away. This means they do the rechaka function. In pranayama has two functions. Puraka, rechaka. Puraka is filling up, rechaka is going out. So rechaka means emptying out or throwing out. So that expels the air within the body. There is a third thing, kumbhaka. Puraka, pranayama consists of puraka, rechaka and kumbhaka. Puraka is filling in, rechaka is going out. Kumbhaka is holding on the breath without exhaling or inhaling. Without exhaling or inhaling. Even there are two things in kumbhaka. I'm getting into some details about the pranayama, but that is very relevant to this shloka. The in kumbhaka, kumbha means holding on, it is all just there, right? Is holding on the breath without exhaling or inhaling. There is an internal kumbhaka, there is an external kumbhaka. What is the internal kumbhaka? Draw in the air according to one's capacity and then hold on to it. Draw in the air according to one's capacity and then hold on to it. By stopping or preventing both inhalation and exhalation. So we inhale, draw in the air, and now we stop. We don't inhale or exhale. That is kumbhaka. The air stays inside. This is internal kumbhaka. External kumbhaka is a little more complicated. Expel all the air according to one's capacity. So exhale. And then stop the inhalation and exhalation. Right, that is external kumbhaka. Thus, pranayama has three components: puraka, rechaka, and kumbhaka. Kumbhaka has those two things, forget it now. Now, these three are mentioned in the first line. Apane juhvati pranam, prane panam tata pare. The other two lines, pranapana gati rudhva, pranayama parayana, 29 second line, second part, apare niyatahara pranan praneshu juhvati. These two lines, so I am actually taking three lines, 29 full and 30 first half. So these two lines, the latter two lines, mention something called the fourth pranayama. What is the fourth pranayama? I told you pranayama has three things, Purka, Rechaka and Kumbhaka. There is a fourth pranayama. I have taken all these things from Patanjali Yoga Shastra. Now the other two lines mention the fourth pranayama called Kevala Kumbhaka. Pranayama Paravayanaha. Those who remain engaged in pranayama consistently and for a long time, that is experts. Pranayama parayana, they are all experts in pranayama. Right? Pranapana gati rudhva. I am reading second line of 29. Pranapana gati rudhva pranayama parayana. Pranayama parayana, the experts who have been consistently doing pranayama and for a long time. Pranapana gati rudhva. They stop both prana and apana, but in a calculated way, exhalation and inhalation alternately, successively and simultaneously perhaps, when they are reach a certain advanced stage. Don't try these things just because I am telling you. You one has to do these things under the direct supervision of a guru. I am just telling you the theory behind these things because this is important for the understanding of the shloka. So, pranapana gati rudhva, stopping exhalation and inhalation successively and simultaneously. Niyatahara, they are well regulated in their food. Juhvati, what do they do? Juhvati, right? Pranapana gati rudhva pranayama parayana. Go to 30, first line, 30, shloka number 30. Apare niyatahara. Netaharaha, well regulated in their food. Pranan praneshu juhvati. Pranan praneshu juhvati. Pranan, the pranas. Here pranas in the form of sense organs and motor organs. Right? Sense organs and motor organs. All the pranan. Praneshu juhvati. They are sacrificed in the vital forces. Praneshu. Of course, they have already practiced the external and internal kumbhaka very carefully all these years. So with that practice they are able to do it. So niyataharaha pranan praneshu jukvati. So taking these three lines, the first line tells you the ordinary pranayama, apane jukvati pranam, that is pranam apane jukvati. So the outgoing breath is sacrificed, is offered to the in-breath. So it is the in-breath that dominates, so that is the puraka function. Prane apanam tatapare. So the other side. So this is the ordinary pranayama. Pranapana gati rudhva pranayama parayana. The experts, advanced people, pranapana gati rudhva, they prevent both, what should I do? They stop exhalation and inhalation successively and simultaneously, perhaps at an advanced stage. So, netaharaha pranan praneshu jukvati. All the sense organs and the motor organs are offered to the pranas. Before I go to the next shloka, I have to do a little digression to tell you something about the pranayama. There is what is called a spiritual pranayama. A spiritual pranayama. I got it, I mean all of us can learn it from Saundarya Lakari, shloka number 61. Kanchi Mahaswamigal has given an elaborate commentary on the Saundarya Lakari discourse, which I have, some of them I have translated, attempted a translation in English and published in the Advaitin files. This shloka number 61 says, Asau nasa vamshastuhina girivamshadvajapati tudiyo neriyav palamat palatupas palamasmakamuchicham vahancham tarmukta shishirakaranishvasagalitam samridhyayattasam bahirapichamukta manidharagam. The goddess, he is describing, the Saundari Lahari describes in a latter part of the Saundari Lahari various, describes the actual form, physical form of the goddess. So it starts from the head and the eyes like that. So he has come to the nose now. In shloka number 61, Ambal means goddess. Ambal in Tamil, Amba in Sanskrit. Amba's nose is described. Amba asau nasa vamshaha. The nose is like a bamboo staff, hollow bamboo staff. That is the poet's description. Here is a comparison. The bamboo staff in tradition, in ancient tradition, it is supposed to contain pearls within, in the bamboo. So that tradition is respected here. Asau nasa vamshaha. So this nose of the goddess is compared to the bamboo, the hollow bamboo which contains pearls within. Tvadiyo neriyav palatu palamasmakam ichijam. You see, your nose, let it give us the fruits that we need, whatever deserves, whatever we deserve, let it give. And the second part of the shloka is a beautiful. Vahati antar muktaha yathu. The bamboo stuff inside holds the pearls. So that is the tradition. So that is continued here. Bahirapicha mukta. Goddess, you know, actually the Madhura in Majura, South India, Meenakshi, if you see here, on the left nose, there will be a pendant. Pearl pendant, muttu mukutti, as said in Tamil, muttu mukutti, pearl pendant, that is there on the outside, that is there. Now, the pearls are within the bamboo. What happens? Shishirakara nishwasagalitam. Bahirapicha mukta manidharaha. He has compared it to a bamboo pole. Now the nishwasa galitam, the air breath, incoming breath and outcoming breath, outgoing breath. The outgoing breath comes through the left nostril. And what does it do? In the bamboo, within that there are lots of pearls. By the force of the breath, one pearl comes out, and that is what is seen in the goddess's left nose outside as her pearl pendant. This is the description here. Leave aside the description. The point about the whole thing for Yoga Shastra is the left nose, left nostril. It says, Shishirakara nishwasagalitam. Shishirakara, it doesn't say left. Shishirakara, the cool, moon cooling. Moon cooling, nishwasa. Nishwasa is outgoing breath. Uchwasa is incoming breath. Nishwasa, uchwasa. So, nishwasagalitam, outgoing breath. Outcoming breath, exhalation. Because of that, the pearls are pushed out, one of them is right there. That is what the description here. Now, Yoga Shastra. Yoga Shastra says, when mind is, note this carefully, when mind is drawn towards desire or anger, inhalation is by left nostril, and exhalation is by the right nostril. Remember, the left nostril is the ida out of the two sushumna, sushumna nadi goes the spinal cord nerve. So there is a left nadi and there is a right nadi. Left, I am showing left by this. Left nadi and right nadi. Left is called ida, right is called pingala. Left is the Chandra Nadi, as it is called in Indian things, and the right is called Pingala Surya Nadi, Singala Nadi. The Chinese people call the right one Yang and the left one Yin and Yang. So now this Chandra Nadi is the left. So the Kanchi Mahaswami here says the spiritual pranayama is inhale by the right and exhale by the left. Exhaling by the left. Remember this shloka says Shishira Kara Nishwasa Galitam. By the moon cooling passage, the outgoing breath goes. That is the left. Moon. So that is the left ida. Pingala is the right, which corresponds to the Surya. Yeah, there are so many things about this pranayama, left and right, this business. So the Yoga Shastra says when mind is drawn towards passion, anger, desire, etc., inhale by the left and exhale by the right. But when the mind is having noble thoughts, stays deep in noble thoughts, inhale by the right and exhale by the left. Because if you do that, Surya Shakti increases. Surya Shakti. Because you inhale by the right, the Surya Nadi, so you take it in. So that is it. When, of course, one is when mind is full of anger and desire, it is this way. When mind stays deep in noble thoughts, right inhalation and left exhalation. And that is what is said in the in goddess's case. When no thought is passing in the mind, you see, desire, anger is of one kind, noble thoughts, but no thought is passing, that is the Kumbhaka stage, right? It appears that the Ida Chandra Nadi, left nadi, controls all the mental processes. Chandra Nadi, mental processes. The Surya Nadi, the Pingala Nadi, controls all the pranas, vital forces. Anyway, that is not relevant here. I thought I will just say this. Anyway, Shishira Kara Nishwasa Galitam, Kanchi Mahaswami says, this is the spiritual pranayama. Spiritual. If you want to ascend on the spiritual, go on higher up on the spiritual ladder, you must practice pranayama by inhaling in the right and exhaling by the left. This is anyway. So that is pranapana gati rudva pranayama parayana. That is, as I told you, it's a digression from Saundarya Lahari. And apare niyatahara pranayan pranayeshu juhvati. That is shloka number 30, first line. So we go to the second line. Sarve pyete yajna vidho yajna kshapita kalmashoha. And then shloka number 31. Yajna shishta amrita bhujo yanti brahma sanatanam nayam lokostya yajnasya kuto unya guru sattama sarvepi yete yajna vidaha. Sarvepi, all these people. We have been talking of so many people now. Different yajnas and apare, we said others do it this way, others do it this way. We have been talking about it. Sarve pete, all of them, yete sarve pi. Yajna vidaha, they understand what is yajna. What is the principle behind yajna? The principle behind yajna is lift the lower entity to the higher entity, almost by a self-effacement. Sarve pete yajna vidaha, yajna kshapita kalmashaha. Their sins, kalmashaha, sins, kshapita, yajna kshapita, they have been absolved, destroyed, dissolved by yajna, by the yajna. Yajna shishta amrita bhujo. Yajnasishta Amrita Bujo Yanti Brahma Sanatanam. Recall the third chapter where we had a similar shloka. Yajnasishta Shinasanto Muchyante Sarvakil Bishai. Yajnasishta, there when he described Yajna, he said, those who eat the prasad of the Yajna, what was left of the Yajna? Yajnasishta Shinasantaha. So those sadhus Muchyante Sarvakil Bishai, they are released from all sins. They are absolved of all sins, they said there. So what is left after the performance of the yajnas? Here also it says the same thing. Yajna shishta amrita bhujaha. Yajna shishta means what is left of the yajna. Amrita, nectar. Nectar. Bhujaha means, bhuja means they are consuming. So they are taking what is left of the yajna. Yanti Brahma Sanatanam, they reach the absolute destination, Brahman. This is for the positive side. For the positive side. The negative side also he describes in the next part. Shloka number 31, second part. Nayam lokosya yajnasya kutonya kurusattama. Na ayam lokaha asti ayajnasya, ayajnasya. What is ayajnasya? Yajna is, okay, ayajna, whoever does not do any yajna, anything as yajna. You see, everything has to be done as yajna. If you give, if you charity, or if you do your work, do social service, or you do a ritual, do a worship, anything has to be done as a yajna, selfishly, unselfishly, dedicated action, efficiently. You have to do it efficiently. You see, kuru karma eva tasmatvam karma, kuru karma samachara, do it well, it said. So, ayajnasya, the one who does not do any type of yajna, anyone that is described here or anything else, na ayam lokaha asti, even this world is not for him. He will not get anything. He will not, first of all, he will not be materialist. In the materialistic world, he will not be successful. What to speak of the other world? Kutonya kurusattama. Kutonyaha. What to speak of the kutaha adnyaha. What to speak of the other world? So there is a kind of a glorification of the yajna. And that's shloka number 31. And in 32, he winds up. Evam bahu vidha yajna mitata brahmano mukhe karmajan vidhitan sarvan evam nyatva vimokshyase. Evam bahu vidha yajna, multifarious yajnas, various kinds of yajnas I have described to you. Vitata brahmano mukhe, they have been written, described, explained, they have been prescribed. Brahmana, Brahmana here means Vedas. Brahmano Mukhi, the Vedas have taught about various kinds of yajnas, kinds of sacrifices. They lie spread at the mouth of the Vedas. They are known only through the Vedas anyway. But what is their quality? Karmajan vidhitan sarvan. Beautiful line, you have to underline it, you have to mark it red. Karmajan vidhitan sarvan. Evam nyatva vimokshase. All of them are action oriented. Karmajan. Karma, action. Karmajan vidhi. Understand them to be action oriented. You see, they are all born of action, physical, oral or mental, whatever. They are not born of the self. The self is actionless. So karmajan vidhijan sarvan, tan sarvan, karmajan vidhi. Understand all of them to be born out of action, action oriented. Evam nyatva vimokshase. This is what you have to learn. These sacrifices are not the functions of the self. Evam nyatva, by knowing this, by knowing what? Knowing that I am, the self is actionless. The self is actionless. So you see, he is coming, remember, the whole undercurrent is actionlessness. which started somewhere in Tasya Kartaram, Shloka number 13. Which started in Shloka number 13. The actionlessness is the undercurrent. And he tells you how to do the action. And how to do the action, he tells you the various yajnas. Then he finally says, all of these are action-oriented, but the self is actionless. Evam yatva, by knowing this, you will be released. You will be liberated. So now he says, Shloka number 33, Shreyan dravyamayat yajnat jnana yajna param tapam sarvam karma khilam partha jnane parisamapyate. Shloka number 33. Shreyan dravyamayat yajnat. Dravyamayat yajnat. What is best? Shreyan means what is commendable. What is best? What is better? Dravyamayat yajnat. All the material oriented yajnas. Dravya means matter. Dravya means matter, material. All except Jnana Yoga, Jnana Yajna. What is Jnana Yajna? Jnana Yajna is the pursuit of wisdom unselfishly in order to learn and know the truth. Jnana Yajna. That Jnana Yajna is the best, is the most commendable, is number one. Everything else is material oriented. Shreyan dravyamayat yajnat jnana yajnat parantapa sarvam karma khilam partha. All of them, karma khilam partha, they are all full of action, action, nothing but action. When such a thing, a material sacrifice engenders or results in fruit. You have to enjoy that fruit. You have to take that result. So, there is a transmigration, samsara, which is involved. Not so the sacrifice of knowledge. So, that is jnana yajna. That is shreyan, more commendable. What is knowledge here? Knowledge means the realization of the identity of Brahman and the Atman, the individual self and the absolute consciousness. Of course, there are lots of scriptural quotations to substantiate this. Just one or two. Tamayatam vedanu vachanena brahmana vividishanti yajnena danena tapasa anashakena yetameva viditva munirbhavati. This is not poetry, this is prose. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Most of it is in prose. So I read it like that. Tamesam Vedanu Vachanena Brahmana Vividishanti. The Brahmana seek to know. Brahmana Vividishanti. Seek to know through the study of the Vedas. Yajnana. So first of all they study, then they do yajna or dana, charity, or tapasa by penance, anashakena, by dispassionate enjoyment of sense objects, anashakena, yetameva viditva munir bhavati. By doing this, they become a muni. This is what all seekers, all brahmana, brahmanas means seekers of Brahman, this is what they do. And therefore, no, the jnana yajna is the realization of the identity of Brahman and Atman. To know the truth, this is what everybody does. Sarvam karma kelam partha jnane parisama apyate. Because dharmena papam apanudati is another quotation, which says, scriptures assert that whatever good other creatures do, all that merit goes to such a person of knowledge. I hope you understand this. That is, there is a Brahmajnani. There is a Sisaprajna. He is doing every action as a yajna. Already we have described such persons. Such a person, you see, what good other people do, that those good things go to him. He does not have to do anything. Tasya kardyam na vidyate. Actually, Shankaracharya in his Bhashya on Brahma Sutra, 3rd Adhyaya, 4th Pada, Sutra number 26, he says very clearly, you see, all religious activities like yajnas are necessary. You see, because it is said, tasya karyam na vidyate, you cannot say, I don't want to have to do anything, I will just go and sit quiet and I will forget the loka, I will forget everything. You cannot do that, and we have said it many times. The Shankara says, Acharya says, on the strength of the Upanishads, because once knowledge has emerged, slowly, understand, once knowledge has emerged, jnanam, rise of knowledge, jnanam has come, it does not depend upon any other factor for producing its own result, namely liberation. But for jnana to emerge, you need so many things, all the rituals, all the sacrifices, all the yajnas. This is. They themselves will not give you moksha. The yajnas will not, any action will not result in moksha. Please understand. No action will result in moksha. Only jnana, the rise of knowledge, will result in moksha, will result in liberation. So that does not mean that religious rituals, sacrifices, yajnas are not necessary, because without that mind will not get purified. Understand carefully. Yajnas, karma, ritual, religious things, worship, everything, they purify the mind. Only after purification, knowledge will rise. You see, Smriti texts also say, the duties result in scorching away sins. The supreme goal being knowledge, when sins are set scorched by duties, knowledge begins to emerge. Slowly understand this. The duties scorch away sins. When the sins are scorched by duties, knowledge begins to emerge. So are the duties, obligations, rituals, sacrifices, are they necessary or not? Now look at this analogy, ordinary, beautiful analogy. There is a dam. Dam, water on that side. Dam is closed. Gates of the dam are closed. When the gates are opened, water flows. Now water flows because of the gates, because of the open gates? No. The water flows by its own nature. Water has to flow. It's a nature. The knowledge, the nature of Brahman knowledge is to rise in you. You are already Brahman. So when you, there are obstacles. So the gates of the dam are only obstacles. You remove the obstacles. When you remove the obstacles, water by its own nature flows. Understand this carefully. Same way, all religious duties and sacrifices are necessary in this sense. They do not directly give you moksha. They do not directly produce rise of knowledge. Knowledge is already there. You are Brahman. You have only to remove the obstacles, remove the ajnana, remove the ignorance. Then automatically, the knowledge emerges. Work purifies the mind. The knowledge of the self is manifested in such a pure mind. So then, we have talked so much about this knowledge. What is that knowledge? Where are we going to get that knowledge? Who will give me that knowledge? That is the question, right? What is the most proximate means for its acquisition? The next shloka is famous. It's the 5-star shloka which comes now. Shloka number 34. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevayam upadekshyanti te jnanam jnaninas tattvadarshinaham. Beautiful shloka, again to be marked in red, embroidered in gold. Tadvidhi, first let me tell you the ordinary meaning. Tadvidhi pranipatena. Tadviddhi, understand that, know that, viddhi, know that, tati. Vittati, just now I said, knowledge. Where does that knowledge come? Sarvam karma khilam partha jnane parisamapyate, it said. Everything ends in knowledge. Where does that knowledge come? Sat viddhi. Get that knowledge. How? Pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Go to a teacher. Prostrate to him. Pranipatha. Prostrate to him. Completely surrender to him. Pranipatena pariprasnena. Go and ask him questions. Ask him repeated questions. Analyze what he says. Right? Sevaya. Prati pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Right? In upadekshantite jnanam, te tattvadarshinaha, those jnanis, those sages, te jnanam upadekshanti, they will teach you. But it is a plural here. Sattva-darshinaha. This plural does not mean you go to this guru, you go to that guru, you go to that guru. No. And then choose. Only one person, only one guru. That he will teach you. That is why this plural is used here, because of respect. Great sages. So because of respect. Not to indicate you should go to many teachers. But only knowledge imparted by those who have realized the truth is effective. That is another thing. You see, this is what confuses people. It says, only knowledge imparted by those who have realized the truth. The guru himself must have realized the truth. Not from book knowledge, by his personal experience. There are again beautiful quotations for this. Here is one from Kathopanishad. Nanarena varena prokta yesha suvigneyo bahudha chintya manaham ananya prokte gatiratra nasti aniyanhi atarkyamanu pramanat. Arena avarena proktaha suvigneyaha bahudha chintya manaha na yesha. This knowledge will not be got from ordinary people, narena, avarena. You have to go to really super. Suvigneyaha bahudha chintyamanaha. One has to think about it very carefully. Bahudha, other people, there are various ways in which they thought about. Ananya prokte gatiratranasi. Ananya prokte. The one who has identified himself with the absolute. The one who has identified himself with the absolute. In the Saundari Lahari also and various other places, Tvam Aham Aham, that is, Tvam Aham, I am Brahman, that identification should be there. That identification, without that, Ananya Prokte, somebody who has not identified himself with the absolute, is him. Somebody who has not identified himself with the absolute will not give you the knowledge. One who has identified himself, he is non-different from the absolute. Ananya prokte gatiratra nasti. There is no more argument. Aniyanhi atarkyam anupramanat. Because it is so subtle, atarkyam, it is not amenable to argument. Anupramanat, it is subtler than the atom, the smallest thing. So you have to go to him. And there are three things mentioned here. Pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Pranipata is namaskar, pariprasna is questioning, seva is service. Dr. Radhakrishnan, in his commentary on the Gita, compares these three, pranipata, pariprasna and seva. This is a very important shloka. In fact, Acharya Vinobha Bhave, when he was in the prison in those times before independence, when he was in prison, he used to teach the other people, other inmates of the prison, Gita. And on this shloka he spent days and days and days. Sadhvidhipranipatena pariprasnena sevayam upadechyantite jnanam jnanina sattvadarshana. They seem to have asked a lot of questions and he has told them. This is all in a book form. We are not getting into all that elaboration. But the point here is, Dr. Radhakrishnan compares the pranipata pariprasna seva. Pranipata is namaskar, prostration. Pariprasna is questioning. Seva is service. He compares these three to shravana, manana, nididhyasana. The analogy is a little far-fetched according to me. It is not, I am not able to get it fully in my mind, but I will tell you. Pranipata is taken as a shravana. It indicates that which is revealed in the scriptures. Pranipata pariprasna. Pariprasnena manana. That is what is thought out by the mind after a thorough analysis. Manana. Shravana manana. Shravana is listening. Manana is analysis. Seva. Nididhyasana. By service. One realizes by the spirit through service and meditation. Service and meditation you make you realize. In spiritual life anyway, it is first you have to have faith, then knowledge, then anubhava. That is the sequence. Faith, knowledge, anubhava. This is the sequential order. So that is the way one acquires spiritual knowledge. Sadhvidhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevayam upadekshantite jnanam jnaninas tattvadarshinam. You see, Krishna started with something like the avatar rahasya and then talked about yajna and then talked about actionlessness. Actually, everything is jnana. That is why this chapter is called Karma Sanyasa Yoga, Brahmarpana Yoga, Jnana Karma Sanyasa Yoga, like. So this is in the Karma Kanda, the first six chapters are supposed to be Karma Yoga, next six chapters are supposed to be Bhakti Yoga, last six chapters are supposed to be Jnana Yoga. But you will find, when you carefully read to it, in Karma Yoga section, you will see a lot of Jnana and Bhakti. In the Bhakti Yoga section, you will see a lot of Karma and Jnana. And in the Jnana Yoga section, you will see a lot of Karma and Bhakti. Yeah, that is the style of Gita. That is why all the three are going to be integrated when we come to the 18th chapter. Upadechyantite jnanam jnaninas tattvadarshinaham. So what will result from the generation of such a knowledge? The next shloka describes Yajnatva, shloka number 35. Yajnatva na punarmoham evam yasyasi pandava yena bhutanya sheshena drakshasyatman yathomayi. Yajnatva na punarmoham. By knowing this yajnatva, again you will not get into this kind of delusion. Your delusion is whether to fight with my gurus, whether to fight with my elders, whether to fight with my cousins. This is your great delusion. You are in a terrific ignorant delusion. Yajna moha. Yajnatva na punar moham. By knowing this, that knowledge, sadvidhi pranipatena, by going to a guru and seeking that knowledge, yajnatva na punar moham evam yasyasi pandava. You will never get this kind of delusion. Yena bhutanya sheshena. Yena bhutanya sheshena. Yena, by this knowledge, bhutani. Asheshena drachyasi atmani. You will see all beings. What is that knowledge? What will that knowledge do? Is the question that I posed before beginning this shloka. So, you will be able to see, visualize all the beings in the self. Not only in the self, in me. The self and me are the same. Here, of course, the three philosophers, Advaita, Vishishtadvaita and Dvaita, they slightly play with the words. Atho mayi, it says, drakshasi atmani, you will see them in the self, in me, mayi, atho, atho. Atha means then, also. So, the non-Advaita people say, afterwards, first you will see it in yourself, then you will see it in the Lord. I mean, Advaita interpretation is, you will see it in yourself and also in me, because both are the same. We should not split our arguments about who is right and who is wrong. In fact, all the three might be right, because they are all great seers. They have seen the Absolute in their own way. They have first-hand experience. They are talking from their own anubhava. So we should follow one of these masters, and that it should be sufficient. And what we are doing here is following Shankara, the great Shankaracharya. Yena bhutanya sheshena, without exception, asheshena, without exception, all the beings you will be able to see in yourself. But what does that mean? That means you will be become. You see everything, you are everything. You are sarvam kalvidam brahma. You are everything. This is what you will be able to realize. So that is the knowledge I am talking about. And that is where we are going to stop today. We will continue in the next session with shloka number 36. Swasti prajabhya paripalayantam nyayena margena mahim mahishaho gobrahmane bhashubhamastu nityam lokasamastha sukino bhavantu om tat sat.